The story of Chianti, a much-beloved red fruit-driven wine, begins as so many of the best stories do, with a fierce territorial dispute between two Italian city-states settled, ultimately, by a rooster. Hello and welcome to Quince. In this video, we're talking about Chianti, exploring what it is, what it tastes like, complex Italian classification structures, history, and more. Let's dive in. Italy, somewhere between Florence and Siena, Middle Ages. Both the Florentine and Sienese republics wanted control of the Chianti region. To settle things, once and for all, they agreed to a bloodless duel of sorts. Here's how it worked. Each city-state elected a knight to represent their interests. At dawn, on the day of the challenge, the knights would be awakened by the crowing of a rooster and would immediately ride toward the opposing city. The border between the two city-states would then be drawn wherever the two knights met on their journey, and the battle for control would be decided firmly, finally, fairly, and for all time. Easy. For the job of alarm clock, or alarm cockerel, as it were, the Sienese selected a white rooster. He was well-fed and well-looked after in the days leading up to the challenge, while the Florentines chose a black rooster and more or less left him to go hungry. As a result of not having had enough food, the black rooster crowed much earlier than his Sienese counterpart and sent the Florentine rider off well before dawn. Legend has it that the knights met less than 15 kilometers outside of Siena, to the lingering displeasure of the Sienese. And with that, Florence won control of Chianti, and the black rooster attained lasting fame as a symbol of the region and of outstanding Chianti wine, as today you can find a black rooster in a red circle embossed on all bottles of Chianti Classico. That's all very nice, but what is Chianti? Well, at the most basic level, Chianti is a dry, medium-bodied red wine named for the Chianti region in Tuscany, where it's from. Chianti is also a Sangiovese-based wine, and while some Chianti is 100% Sangiovese, other Chiantis are blends. In a Chianti blend, Sangiovese is mixed with other Italian grapes like Canaiolo, Ciliegolo, and Colorino, or international grapes like Cabernet, Merlot, or Syrah, which round out the initial Sangiovese punch. All Chianti contain Sangiovese grapes, but not all Sangiovese grapes are Chianti. More on that later. Incidentally, Sangiovese is a blue-black grape that takes its name from the phrase Sanguis Jovis, which translates to Blood of Jove or Jupiter, Jupiter being the Roman god of thunder. So, theoretically, when you drink a glass of Chianti, you're actually drinking the blood of the gods. If you've enjoyed that fact, or if you're just feeling nice at the minute, please like this video or even subscribe. Anyway, on to the more important stuff. What does Chianti taste like? To have a really decent idea about what this wine is like, it's important first to understand the region's unique geography and topography. Chianti has a somewhat variable climate. A good vintage benefits from sunny Italian summers with gentle coastal breezes and milder winters. Elevation, via the famous Chianti Hills, also affects this wine, as cooler nights enable the grapes to retain their acidity, while more intense, direct exposure to sunlight during the day results in stronger tannins. The soil is a combination of alberese, which is a very hard mix of clay and limestone, and galestro, which is clay-like and comes apart easily. While alberese produces wines with high acidity, galestro-grown wines tend to boast deeper, more complex flavors. The result is a hearty, red fruit-driven, yet earthy wine. You may notice cherry or strawberry notes, followed by spice, smoke, soft leather, or even game. Blending the herbaceous with the fruity, Chianti is something of a study in opposition, for which we love it all the more. To serve, first and most critically, decant your Chianti well before you plan on serving it. We cannot overstate this. If you fail to properly decant, you'll likely be in for a dull, insipid, frankly unpalatable experience, which isn't fair to you or to the Chianti. When you serve it, the wine should be very lightly chilled at around 60 degrees Fahrenheit or 15.6 degrees Celsius. A standard red wine glass is absolutely fine. If you're like many when you think of Chianti, you think of a rather distinctive bulbous bottle covered by woven straw matting, aptly called a fiasco. These design features, it is argued, enabled merchants to fit more bottles into a smaller space, and the fiaschi, plural for fiasco, provided a sort of cushion, which prevented the bottles from breaking as they clanged against each other during transport. While this was true of historical Chianti, today most Chianti worth drinking comes in traditional wine bottles. Now that you've successfully decanted and chilled your Chianti, you may be wondering what to pair it with. Chianti's high acidity makes it a great wine for food, especially heavy Italian food. We like it with pasta, pizza, cheese, and unadorned meat, like steak. I'm underlining the pizza pairing here, though, as it's phenomenal with mozzarella-heavy margarita or really any ultra-cheesy cheese pizza. If your idea of heaven involves biting into a pizza while being surrounded by fresh cherries, tobacco smoke, and dirt, this is the place. In any case, the formula here is simple. Rich food plus high acidity equals good times. Getting into specific cheese pairings, many people recommend Parmigiano-Reggiano, a hard, salty cheese which complements Chianti's plum and red fruit flavors, or for the full Tuscan experience, try Pecorino Toscano, a firm ewe's milk cheese which boasts a unique location-dependent flavor. Personally, and I hope not to be skewered by anyone, but I quite enjoy Chianti with a herbaceous goat's cheese. And if you're not ready to uncork your Chianti just yet, no worries. Many Chiantis are fairly age-worthy. A Chianti Classico can be aged for up to 10 years, while a Riserva can develop for 15. Anything past this point, however, will likely result in diminishing returns. Okay, it's the part in the video where we attempt to discuss what is probably the most confusing classification system I have yet come across in the wine world. Italy's and Chianti's classification structure has been altered, amended, and revised quite a few times over the years, so we may get some of this wrong. Hopefully not. If we do, let us know in the comments below. Also, if this is not really your thing and you don't enjoy masochism, we fully recommend skipping to the next section. So without further ado, I give you the Chianti classification conundrum. First off, we have both DOC and DOCG wines, which stand for Denominazione di Origine Controllata and Denominazione di Origine Controllata e Garantita, respectively. DOC wines must be grown according to certain rules and only in certain regions, while DOCG wines must meet a slightly higher standard. They are formally, governmentally guaranteed to be of high quality and even undergo a taste test before release. In addition to these major classifications, we have Vino da tavola, or table wine, and IGT, or Indicazione Geografica Tipica. Both of these categories refer to wines that do not follow the rules of the DOC, with one distinction. Vino da tavola tends to be of lower quality, while IGT can be higher quality. Think Super Tuscans. Moving into Chianti-specific categorizations, we come to Chianti DOCG, which refers to wines that are at least 70% Sangiovese and at most 10% white grapes. Alternative international and Italian red grapes are also permitted in these blends. Chianti Superiore and Chianti Riserva fall under this category. Superiore means higher and indicates that a wine has been aged for 9 months before release, while Riserva simply means reserve and means that a wine has been aged for at least 24 months. There are also 7 subregions of the Chianti DOCG, each producing a different style of Chianti. They are Chianti Colliarettini, known for its open and somewhat brutalist bouquet characterized by tart cherry and chocolate notes, Chianti Colli Fiorentini, which is located next to Florence and mainly produces wines destined for local consumption and often meant to be drunk young, Chianti Colline Pisane, vineyards located near the sea, result in lighter-bodied, vaguely floral wines, Chianti Colli Sienese, which is a well-known, well-regarded subsection producing more or less what we think of when we think of Chianti. I love this area for full-flavored cherry and dark red fruit notes. Chianti Montalbano for fruit-forward, bright young wines. Chianti Montespertoli for more age-worthy Chianti, and Chianti Rufina, which is very, very well regarded and finishes well. Then we have Chianti Classico, which is its own DOCG. Delimited by the Medicis in 1716, Chianti Classico consists of 4 main villages in the center of the Chianti region: Castellina, Gaiole, Greve, and Rada. All Chianti Classico wines must be made exclusively from grapes harvested from the best, reed most elevated vineyards in the region. You might think of this as OG Chianti territory, and its products, as expected, are top quality, with bright acidity, firm tannins, and better aging potential. A Chianti Classico is always 80% Sangiovese, 20% other red grapes, and never contains any white grapes. These wines are also at least 12% ABV. Chianti Classico status is indicated on the bottle by a black rooster. Within this category, Chianti is further broken down into Annata, Riserva, and Gran Selezione. Annata is aged for 12 months, Riserva for 24 months, and Gran Selezione for 30. Keeping up? Good, because now we're introducing the star of the IGT, the Super Tuscan. But first, a bit of background. Post-World War II, Chianti was doing very, very well. A run of increasing global popularity and limited vineyard space meant the inexpensive wine was in demand. So, the powers that be decided to enter altruistic cash grab mode. In a bid to produce more wine for the people around the world to enjoy, they expanded the borders of Chianti and permitted vintners to add up to 20% white grapes to their blend and still call it Chianti. The result? A reputation for mediocrity, which adversely affected almost the entire Chianti region for a very long time. And with just a little gerrymandering, Chianti lovers the world over were transformed into haters overnight. But then, we all go through squiffy periods, don't we? I should say that these days Chianti is very much back. Anyway, the governing body responded to the drop-off in quality and interest with the creation of the Chianti Classico designation in 1967 to serve as a sort of mark of quality. The rules governing Chianti making became stricter, and some vintners were unimpressed. They decided to make wine their way, outside the rules of the DOC. In other words, distinctly not Chianti. They called the end result the Super Tuscan. Super Tuscans can combine Sangiovese, or occasionally other Tuscan grapes, with French grape varietals like Cab Franc, Cab Sav, Merlot, or Syrah, or maybe 100% international, 100% Merlot, for example. They are also often subjected to barrique aging, another adoption from Bordeaux. The resulting wine is a bit of a powerhouse, oak-heavy, rich, dark fruit flavors, and sometimes high alcohol. Eventually, of course, classification caught up. In 1992, they created IGT, which today includes most Super Tuscans. And that's Chianti. Sincerely hoping that made sense and is accurate, as a lot of this stuff is fairly fluid. Anyway, thoroughly recommend checking out Chianti. General advice would be to avoid anything in a fiasco. A lot of times you can get exceptional regional Chianti for less than the Chianti Classico price without necessarily sacrificing quality. So, what do you think of Chianti? Be sure to let us know in the comments below. Cheers! If you'd like to learn more about wine, click the subscribe button or check out our other videos in our Understanding Wine series now. If you'd like to see more videos like this one, please consider supporting us on Patreon at the link in the description box below. As a Quince patron, you'll get early access to future videos and can even vote on upcoming video topics. Our amazing patrons allow us to work on these videos full-time and make them as good as we possibly can. Thank you all very, very much for your support.